part two of our study of Jean-Paul Sartre's really existentialist novel, Nausea. I thought originally that I might be able to jam-pack everything that I thought needed to be said about it or explored within it into the space of 1 hour, and quickly realized that that was a quixotic enterprise. As soon as I'd reached about the 40-minute mark, and I'd gotten through only a portion of what I thought were important points about the book. And we didn't actually get to some of the more metaphysical points that Sartre is himself making in this, which you'll see coming up again in his other works, particularly in Being and Nothingness. He's carrying out an analysis of what it is to be a human being in the world through that. But he's also doing that in this novel. We talked about the problem of trying to figure out who one is and what one is in the world. And we talked about this condition that he was experiencing, the main character, Roquentin, that he calls nausea. And we distinguished that from several other psychological or physiological or spiritual states. And then we looked at a few different characters besides Roquentin that came up in the book. One of which was this Marquis de Willebon, who he'd been writing a historical study, his book that was a project that he was working on, trying to bring back life to this character that had fascinated him. And I can really understand that myself, because I'm actually a historian of philosophy. A lot of what I do is to try to bring back to life, not usually necessarily in an entire book, but at least in a class session or in a study, the thinker who I'm working on. You try to get to know them. You try to make sense out of them. You try to see the world through their eyes. And he's got this beautiful passage where he said that I was trying to let Roquentin live through me, and he was deriving his existence from me. And what was I getting from? Here's one of the key themes. I didn't have to think about my own existence. I didn't have to have true self-knowledge. I was able to be satisfied with sort of superficial self-knowledge of who I am, what's going on, what am I involved in. Roquentin abandons his project of trying to bring back the Marquis de Willebon to life. There's three other characters who we talked about, or three types of characters who we talked about in the last video. And I just want to recall that to mind, because they're not going to come up in this, but their importance, what they stand for, will come up. So one was this broad category of the bourgeois. And there's a lot of different bourgeois characters in this, and they are sort of satisfied in their own existence, but they exist on a surface level. They categorize everybody, everything on the basis, and this is where temporality comes into it, on the basis of the dead past, which then they project onto the present, instead of looking at the present and seeing what's actually there. And what they do thereby is they force the world into the confines of the categories that they are comfortable with. And they do this sometimes in sort of just conformist, going with the flow kind of ways. Sometimes they do this in very heroic, dynamic ways, which are nevertheless not made better by the fact that they are more dynamic, more forceful for somebody like Sartre. Then there was this character, Monsieur Achille, another person who is suffering from the nausea that Roquentin is suffering from, a fellow sufferer with whom he doesn't actually feel solidarity. Because nausea, in this ontological, metaphysical nausea, is not that sort of thing where you would say, oh, you've got a cold too? I know how you feel. It doesn't make you feel better that another person has it. And it's not something that you can remedy just by hooking up with another person. And Achille betrays himself. He allows the bourgeois doctor to define him. And he takes that on. And Roquentin looks at that and he says, that's a mistake. You shouldn't be doing that. If you're going to be an existentialist, so here's the meat, here's the take home from that. If you're going to be an existentialist, you cannot allow the bourgeois, the establishment, even the counterculture in our own time, the anti-establishment, to define you, to categorize you, to tell you who you are. If you do that, you're accepting something that solves some things, closes off some things that really should not be closed off yet, that you have to explore yourself. You're taking the easy way out. You're having a failure of nerve. Then there's the self-taught man, who is in some ways a more sympathetic and a more complex character, but he's a humanist. And Sartre, even though he's, you know, he's got this famous essay, Existentialism is a Humanism, if existentialism is a humanism, it's a humanism that's a very, very different kind than any other kind of humanism, because all other kinds of humanism define man or define human being in their essence, and then they look at all the individual ones and they say, ah, there's an example, there's an example, there's an example, there's an example. That existence has that essence. That existence has that essence. And so the self-taught man is able to love human beings because they're human beings, not because they are this existing human being, and so forth. And that's able to give his life meaning. And Roquentin rejects that. He says, I've been through this, you know. This guy has managed to like roll up all the different kinds of humanism incoherently into himself, and doesn't even realize how badly off he is. Then the self-taught man, and then this famous passage with which we ended the last one, tries to impose categories onto Roquentin to get him to define himself. And again, this is the theme that's going to come up in Sartre's over and over again, of the other. The other tries to categorize you. The other tries to objectify you. They have not only an action of doing that, they have a desire for it. They have a need for it. And to be a courageous existentialist means standing up against that and saying, it's not going to happen. And that's what Roquentin does, and he leaves. That's where we left off before. So, what else needs to be said? Well, I put up these four key themes that now we're going to explore in much greater depth and detail in this session. The first of them is temporality, time. What is the meaning of time? We'll get to that in a moment. And then there's existence. What is existence itself? If we peel back the appearances, if we're taking away the illusions, what's really there? What is life really like? What is the world really like? What are things really like? And then, what am I really like? What are other people really like? Because we're also things in the world. Even though we're things that see the world, that take, you know, a position of the world, we're also things of the world. Before we get into that, though, I want to do a little bit of work on the blackboard talking about some metaphysical issues and sort of charting them out with what's going on here. And you notice I've got these two terms, subject and object. And one of the classic issues in philosophy throughout its existence and its history is, what is the relationship between subject and object? What is the relationship between, say, the human being who knows something that's actually out there? You know, does the object just sort of impose itself on the subject who doesn't make any contribution to it and just, you know, winds up sort of being there as an image or a feeling or a concept or whatever you have in their head? Or is the subject making some contribution to that? Does the object change the subject? Does the subject change the object? What's going on there? And you can think of things as trivial as, you know, this piece of chalk or this notebook or this iPhone or this, even what I'm wearing. You know, these are objects as well that I've clothed myself. What is the relationship of myself as a subject to these objects? What do they mean? How do they get their meaning? Well, one of the things I want to talk about is what the nausea does, what the nausea reveals. And I've talked about this a little bit last time, but not quite so much with this. He begins by saying that he's having a problem with objects, in the way that objects are relating themselves to the subject. And I put these other terms in here, because I think Sartre is inviting us to begin from a kind of commonsensical way of looking at the relationship between subject and object. We get to know objects through perception, right? We perceive the things in the world. You're perceiving me right now if you're watching this video. There's actually an interesting chain of successions going on in terms of what's being perceived. You're probably looking at a computer screen or perhaps on a mobile phone. And so what you're seeing, first off, is actually that object that you're looking at, the screen. But then that screen is itself symbolically mediating images. And through those images, you're actually, however we want to explain it, you're seeing me talking to you. I mean, think about the strangeness, too. What I'm looking at is actually a flip cam camera on a tripod. I'm not seeing you, but I'm talking to you at the same time. And we can have shared meaning back and forth between them. Well, that's pretty interesting to start thinking about wrapping your head around, isn't it? But we're not starting there yet. We're just at the level of, okay, we've got objects, we perceive them, they, you know, you might say they impose themselves on us, they tell us, hey, look over here, I'm here. I'm, you know, hard and white and cylindrical. I'm soft and more or less black, you know, except for chalk spots, and a little bit rough in texture, formed in certain ways. What do we do with objects? Well, we have valuation of them. You know, some things we want, and we could value them in terms of their usability. Why do I like this piece of chalk? You know, I suppose if I had a chalk fetish, I could, like, you know, walk around like that guy, you know, who's always twirling the ball bearings around in his hand, the crazy captain from Caine Mutiny. I can do that with chalk, I suppose. I don't actually do that, but I'm sure there's somebody who does. Then I would be valuing them in a certain way, right? For me, their value is quite a bit lower. I like writing on the board and making sense of the things. So I need the chalk. I very often find bits of chalk in my pockets of my suit coats and sports jackets, in part because I have an absent-minded habit of just dropping them in there as a professor. All of that has to do with evaluation. Also in part with action. We act on objects, don't we? Evaluation, by the way, could include desire, could be how we feel about them, could be antipathy, we want to turn away from certain things, fear, hope, all these affective things fall into evaluation. And then there's action. You know, we do things with objects. I call people on this and text people and then check emails and surf the web. I read this book, you know. I write with this pen. I wear this jacket. I put on this tie. You know, for a variety of different reasons. One is, it goes with, you know, the suit. It's part of a uniform, you might say. The other is, you know, you realize this when you actually get cold, what the original purpose of ties was. If you don't have one, your neck gets cold. So we have all sorts of things that we do. You know, I tie the tie. I phone on the phone. I see an object, I go approach it, I run away from it. Then we have categories. We impose categories on objects, you know. Again, why are these chalk? Well, because we human beings call them chalk and we impose those categories on them. We don't impose the physical characteristics that they have, but we actually decide, you know, they are good for this sort of thing. And we, you know, why is this, for example, why are these also chalk? Why do they fall in the same category? They're not the same color, are they? They don't have the same weight. They're not exactly the same, made of the same material as the high-quality blackboard chalk that I like to work with, the white stuff. But we put them under the same category, don't we? They're all still chalk. And we can differentiate these categories further if we would like to. All that said, that's part of how we approach objects, right? Now, what's happening in Nausea? He's having trouble with objects. Objects are not remaining the same in perception. He talked about Sartre's amazing abilities to phenomenologically describe the appearance of objects, not just, you know, inanimate objects, but also human beings and how they break apart. And one thing that we realize is that we're never just faced with an object. We're faced with objects. And those objects impose themselves upon us. And one of the things that you see here in this is that the back and forth between subject and object becomes a lot more reciprocal. It's not just the subject dominating the world of, that they perceive. That world is actually in some ways threatening the subject, is not staying still, not holding to the categories that he would like it to be in. It's shimmering, it's shifting. And, you know, when he's got that nausea, what gets him out of that? Something that will actually allow him to attain a kind of fixity. These objects, put them all together, and now we actually have the horizon of the world. But one of the things that he's realizing in this is that it's not just a world that's outside him. He's in it too. And among the objects in the world are others who are also themselves facing off with all of these. Things are much more complex, aren't they, than originally thought. So when he has the nausea and everything starts to shake and shimmer and to lose its hardness, its contours, its categories, and he thinks that this is sort of revealing the way things truly are. And this is also happening with other people. It's not just a matter of the subject as this isolated thing which is having this problem outside of itself. The problem is, and it's not just a matter of, you know, some sort of deception occurring on the part of the subject who's then projecting it out there. It's in the interplay. It's in the communication between him and the world. So, with that said, let's now look at how he perceives time, how he gives meaning to time. And Roquentin talks about adventures. It's actually the self-made man who brings this up first. But adventures are the category by which Roquentin had tried to make sense out of time. And one of the things is, early on, he says he's talking about a place that he used to go to, Meknes, and he says, if I close my eyes or stare vaguely at the ceiling, I can recreate the scene, a tree in the distance, a short dingy figure run toward me, but I'm inventing all this to make out a case. The Moroccan was big and weather-beaten, besides I only saw him after he touched me. He's talking about a fight that he had. Still, I know he was big and weather-beaten. Certain details somewhat curtailed live in my memory, but I don't see anything anymore. I don't have those memories anymore. I can search the past in vain. I can only find these scraps of images, and I'm not sure what they represent, whether they are memories or just fiction. There are many cases where even these scraps have disappeared. Nothing is left but words. I could still tell stories, tell them too well as far as anecdotes are concerned. I can stand up to anyone except for ship's officers and professional people, but these are only the skeletons. I want to pause here for a minute, because there's a structural similarity between the objects of the world, the present objects of the world, and the past objects of his memory and the world that was. So the problem that had occurred with nausea was that things suddenly lost their contours, they lost their fixed meanings, they lost their categorizations, things started to degenerate into a kind of not really chaos so much, but an indeterminability, which made him physically ill. What's happening with Sartre's or Roquentin's memory, the same thing. He's got bits of things that don't all seem to fit together anymore, and they don't seem to necessarily represent that living past, because that past no longer exists. All that's left, all the objects, now we're no longer in the world. Now we are in the person and memory. All that's left are the objects, the memories. And many of them are not even memories of images, of what took place. They're only words. They're abstractions. You know, I remember when I was a kid, my father died when I was 11. And when I was 14, 15, 16, I could still remember not only his face very well in a fixed way, but him in movement and in things that he'd said and done and all that. And I could remember what the sound of his voice was. And luckily, I actually had some cassette tapes that had his voice on it. And I would listen to them every once in a while because I missed him very much. You know, boy growing up without a father, that's pretty tough. And I remember when I could no longer remember what his voice sounded like, and I was 16. And I played the cassette, and his voice sounded very unfamiliar. Now, it shouldn't sound very familiar, right? The association of psychology, I'd listen to it over and over again. I should immediately recognize it. But the past was slipping away. Many things like this occur. I think the experience that he's talking about here is something that is easy to relate to after you reach a certain age. So he says, there's the story of a person who does this, does that, but it isn't I. He's got all these stories, all these kind of memories, but they're no longer of him. There's a narrative consistency, but it's no longer who he is. He travels through countries I know no more about than if I had never been there. Sometimes in my story, it happens I pronounce these fine names you read in atlases. New images are born in me, images such as people create from books who've never traveled. My words are dreams, that's all. For 100 dead stories, there still remain one or two living ones. And this is really interesting. I evoke these with caution, occasionally, not too often. Why? For fear of wearing them out. There's a process here. Every time that you awaken one of these memories, maybe you're using up its juice, its power, its staying capacity. I fish one out. Again, I see the scenery, the characters, the attitudes. I stop suddenly. There's a flaw. I see a word pierce through the web of sensations. I suppose this word will soon take the place of several images I love. I must stop quickly and think of something else. I don't want to tire my memories. In vain, the next time I evoke them, a good part will be congealed. They'll be turning into words. And now think about this again in terms of Roquentin and his project of trying to make sense out of the Marquis de Rollable, or his invitation to categorize himself that the self-made man is giving him. Those are words. Those are not the living experiences. Those are not the things themselves. The words are a substitute for them, and the words hold together a hell of a lot better than do the images and the memories. Let me go on a little bit further with this issue about time. He tells himself at a certain point, he'd been wanting to have adventures, and he says, I've never really had adventures. Things have happened to me, events, incidents, anything you like, but no adventures. It isn't a question of words. I am beginning to understand. There is something to which I clung more than all the rest without completely realizing it. And it wasn't love. Love is important, but more than love, and this goes through all of Sartre's works, he wants meaning. And he wants stable meaning, but he doesn't want stable meaning just, you know, in an illusory way, just a web of words. There is something to which I clung more than the rest. Heaven forbid, not glory, not money, it was. I had imagined that at certain times my life could take on a rare and precious quality. There was no need for extraordinary circumstances. All I asked for was a certain precision. So a rare and precious quality, precision, being able to say, this is this, this is what this is, exactly what it is. I understand that, and I think probably a lot of the people hearing this understand that as well. So he says, there's nothing brilliant about my life now, but from time to time, when they play music in the cafes, I look back and tell myself, in the old days, I have known great moments, I have had adventures, now I'm deprived of this. I have suddenly learned without any apparent reason that I've been lying to myself for years. And naturally, everything they tell about in books can happen in real life, but not in the same way. So he says, something is beginning in order to end. Adventure does not let itself draw out. It only makes sense when dead. So you can only look back. You can't actually tell that you're having an adventure, that life has actually taken on all this precision, this meaning, that everything is coming together, that these things, the communication that's taking place is what you might call a fortunate communication in which things make sense and things interact, and you're not bored, and you're not feeling nausea, and you're not uncertain. You can experience that while you're in it, but you can't know that you're in it when you're in it. You can only know about it afterwards, and then you're no longer experiencing it, and then you no longer have it, according to Sartre. Later on, he talks about the irreversibility of time, and this is, again, after that time when he felt like, I think I'm going to have an adventure. I think there's something waiting for me. And we talked about that last session. He says, if I remember correctly, they call that the irreversibility of time. The feeling of adventure would simply be that of the irreversibility of time. But why don't we always have it? Is it that time is not always irreversible? There are moments when you have the impression you can do what you want, go forward or backward, that it has no importance. And then other times when you might say the links have been tightened. In that case, it's not a question of missing your turn because you could never start again. So Annie made the most of time. And we're going to talk about Annie in a few minutes. A little bit later on, the true nature of the present actually reveals itself to him. So now we're getting into something even more deeply metaphysical. And he says, this is while he was writing, and this is when he's actually decided to give up on trying to write about Rollamont. And he says, how can I, who have not the strength to hold to my own past, hope to say the past is somebody else? So he says, I looked anxiously around me, the present, nothing but the present. That's all you can experience, actually, is the present. Furniture light and solid, rooted in its present, a table, a bed, a closet with a mirror, and me. The true nature of the present revealed itself. It is what exists. And all that was not present did not exist. The past did not exist. Not at all. We have the illusion that the past exists because of memory. Memory of images, memory of experiences. And also because we have words, and we can construct entire webs of words that give us the illusion that the past is still there. So he said, the past did not exist, not at all, not in things, not even in my thoughts. It's true that I had realized a long time ago that mine had escaped me. But until then, I believed it had simply gone out of my range. So he thought there was like, an accidental problem, you might say, a problem just on his part. For me, the past was only a pensioning off. It was another way of existing, a state of vacation and inaction. Each event, when it had played its part, put itself politely into a box and became an honorary event. And here's where he says something really interesting. We have so much difficulty imagining nothingness, imagining the past no longer being there whatsoever, not for anybody. We have trouble even wrapping our head around what it is for this past moment not to exist, because we're already still imagining that past moment in order to say that it doesn't exist, aren't we? We're making it exist in a certain way. And then he said, now I knew things are entirely what they appear to be, and behind them, there is nothing. This is it. This is all you get, according to Sartre. There's nothing behind appearances. Sure, you can say that there's things behind appearances in the sense that some people have categories that they've put onto the world, and they view the world through those categories, and those are sort of illusory, and those become an appearance for them. But all they're doing is putting it onto the same things that appear to all the rest of us. What exists? A little bit later yet, he says about thoughts and words and who he is. Thoughts are the dullest things, duller than flesh. They stretch out and there's no end to them, and they leave a funny taste in the mouth. So already, you know, thoughts are not the things themselves, and they're a bad substitute for it. But then there, you can raise it to a higher degree yet. Then there are words inside the thoughts, unfinished words. It's worse than the rest because I feel responsible and have complicity in it. For example, this sort of painful rumination, I exist. I'm the one who keeps it up, I. The body lives by itself once it's begun. But thought, I'm the one who continues it. Unrolls it. I exist. How serpentine is this feeling of existing? I unwind it slowly. If I could keep myself from thinking, well, why can't I? This is very interesting. Sartre is having his own sort of Cartesian cogito at this moment. Sartre, you know, is going back to this great thinker, René Descartes, who said, I think, therefore I am, or I exist. He was much less interested just in that, and much more interested in what is the thing that thinks? What is this me that is a thinking thing? And Sartre is saying, I can't get away from that. That's all I really have. My thought is me. That's why I can't stop. I exist because I think, and I can't stop myself from thinking. At this moment, it's frightful if I exist. It's because I am horrified at existing. I am the one who pulls myself from the nothingness to which I aspire, the hatred, the disgust of existing. There are as many ways to make myself exist, to thrust myself into existence. This is very different than Descartes, isn't it? Descartes is you know, at the beginning of modernity is saying, yeah, I exist. All right. That evil genius or a deceiver or whatever you want to call it that can deceive me about anything else, he can't make me not exist, because as soon as I think to myself, is this right, is this wrong, I exist. I'm the one having these thoughts. There's an optimism there on Descartes' part that is totally reversed on Sartre's part. I can't get away from thinking. This is a trap. I'm stuck here. Even to think about whether I should think or not, I'm stuck in my own thinking. Well, that's what it is to be a human subject for Sartre. And that's what it is for the other to be a human subject, too. We're all stuck in this, according to him. Let's go on now to talk about what this existence actually is. He has this amazing experience. And you know, he's talking about thrusting himself into existence. Well, everything sort of thrusts itself into existence. That's part of what it means to exist. It's not just a purely passive laying there, totally inert. What is it to exist? Let's go on a little bit more. Let's talk about his own existence. He's comparing himself to this news story that he's read about somebody who's been killed. And he says, I am, I exist, I think, therefore I am because I think. Why do I think? I don't want to think anymore. I am because I think that I don't want to be. Even in thinking that you don't want to be, or feeling that you don't want to be, you're thinking. Your existing. I think that I, because, I flee. And then he says, he's got these great lines here. He says, I exist, I think, therefore I toss, I am. Existence is a fallen shoot. Will not fall, will fall. Existence is an imperfection. Existence is constantly what we're making it out to be, what it is that we're thinking about at that given time. That is part of our existence. We are not something outside of existence. We are something I put in the world. Now let's put it as existence. And our way of existence is to connect ourselves with all of these things, whether we like it or not. He has this long metaphysical passage, which now we should take a look at. This is here we go. He's talking about the roots of the chestnut tree. He's in the park and he's had this experience. So suddenly the veil is torn away. I have understood, I have seen. And now he's writing about this. He says, it left me breathless. Never until these last few days had I understood the meaning of existence. I was like the others, like the ones walking along the seashore, all dressed in their spring finery. I said, like them, the ocean is green. That white speck up there is a seagull. But I didn't feel that it existed or that the seagull was an existing seagull. Usually existence hides itself. It's there around us, in us, it is us, but you can't say two words without mentioning it, but you can never touch it. And this is a really interesting and important point. What is it that existence means? Kant had very famously said, there is no more to the concept of 100 existing dollars, actually dollars, but dollars, than $100 being imagined, other than the fact that it just exists. It's real. It's there. There's nothing more contributed to the concept of the thing, to our understanding of it. The human mind recoils from that to a certain degree. We want to know what existence actually does mean. We want to be able to make sense out of it. But it's the hardest thing actually to understand. It's not only Sartre who's grappling with this, it's many other philosophers as well. So he says, if anyone had asked me what existence was, I would have answered in good faith that it was nothing, simply an empty form to, which was added to external things without changing anything in their nature. That's Kant's answer right there. Then all of a sudden there it was, clear as day. Existence had suddenly unveiled itself. It had lost the harmless look of an abstract category. Now that's interesting. It's not harmless. See, this is a very critical point. If things matter to us, if things matter at all, we're vulnerable to them. The subject is vulnerable to the object and to existence and to itself and to the other. They're no longer harmless. It was the very paste of things. This root was needed into existence, or rather the root, the parkades, the bench, the spare grass, all that had vanished. The diversity of things, their individuality, were only an appearance of veneer. This veneer had melted away, leaving soft, monstrous masses, all in disorder, naked, in a frightful, obscene nakedness. When you're seeing things the way they truly are, they're unveiling themselves to us. For Sartre, it's ugly, it's obscene, it's likely to give you nausea. That's why the book is about the existence of nausea. All these objects, they inconvenienced me, he says. I would have liked them to exist, here's a really strange turn of phrase, I would have liked them to exist less strongly, more dryly, in a more abstract way, with more reserve. He would like them to stay within categories. He would like them to be in a Kantian world where 100 real dollars is no different than 100 imaginary dollars, or a imaginary chestnut tree is no different than the real chestnut tree, or the experience that we have of another's flesh, of a kiss, of a caress, of a strike, of a look is no different than the imagination of it. But that's not real. That's not the way it actually is. Kant has got it wrong. And anybody who follows in Kant's lines, according to Sartre, has got it wrong. The real, the existence, has much more to it. And it affects us, not in a merely intellectual way, but an affective way, touching our emotions, our feelings. He says, I realized there was no halfway house between non-existence and this flaunting abundance. If you existed, you had to exist all the way as far as moldiness, bloatedness, obscenity were concerned. As far as, you know, this what we're experiencing. You know, nothing is perfect. Nothing is what its ideal would make it out to be. This is sort of like an absolute reversal of Platonism. With Platonism, you had, you know, the real things that are here, that we consider to be real, are merely copies of something that's perfect and ideal, and doesn't have any of the imperfections that these things have. That's more knowable than what we are. But what Sartre is saying is, look, there, first of all, there isn't anything like that out there. And second of all, yeah, this is it. You know, there's an abstract category of jacket, maybe even black jacket, maybe even this particular, you know, prototype for this one, but this is it. This is what we got here. Same thing with this tie. You know, it exists in the color patterns that it has in this light. And that's it. This is the book that he wrote, not some other book, not an ideal book. We get what we get. And he says, if you existed, you had to exist all the way. Let's go on and look at. Oh, one other thing before we get to that. He talks about absurdity. He also talks about himself. He says, all these objects are revealing themselves. They're also revealing to me who I am, my existence. I, soft, weak, obscene, digesting, juggling with dismal thoughts. Those things are in the way for me, and I am in the way for them as well, and for myself. Instead of just saying, you know, matter takes up space, things can't be in the same place, they're in the way of each other. Intentionality is, you know, how they reveal themselves to each other. They want to be going this way, and something is stuck in the way of them. So he says, even my death would have been in the way. In the way, my corpse, my blood on these stones, between these plants at the back of the smiling garden. And the decomposed flesh would have been in the way. And the earth would have been in the way. In the way of the earth which would receive my bones at last, clean, stripped, peeled, proper, and clean as teeth, I would have been in the way. I was in the way for eternity. This is a fundamental category of existence. This is a fundamental way in which things are. The word absurdity is coming out to life under my pen. I thought without words on things with things. Absurdity was not an idea in my head or the sound of a voice. And without formulating anything clearly, I understood I had found the key to existence, the key to my nauseas, to my own life. In fact, all that I could grasp beyond that returns to this fundamental absurdity. So what is existence? Existence is absurd. In the way. Existence is presence. And you don't get to get rid of it. Even killing yourself. What's left of you would still be in the way, he says. So, this fundamental realization. He ends up talking about nature and change and movement. And this is particularly important to hit on as well. He says, he's seeing that the tree moving. No more than 3 seconds and all my hopes were swept away. I could not attribute the passage of time to these branches groping around like blind men. The idea of passage is still an invention of man. If you're letting things be what they are, then they don't fit our categories. He says, my eyes only encountered completion. The tips of the branches rustled with experience which unceasingly renewed itself and which was never born. The existing wind rested on the tree like a great blue bottle and the tree shuddered. All was fullness, all was active, there was no weakness in time, all, even the least perceptible stirring, was made of existence. And all these existences which bustled about this tree came from nowhere and were going nowhere. Suddenly they existed no longer. Existence is without memory, of the vanished it retains nothing, not even a memory. Existence everywhere, infinitely, in excess. That's another key thing here. It's excessive. Existence, which is limited only by existence. And then I thought to myself, why so many existences, since they're all so alike? So many existences missed, obstinately begun again and again, missed. That abundance did not give the effect of generosity, just the opposite. Existence is tragic. Hostile. And in certain respects, sick. He says, I thought of all these things, these idiots that talk about willpower, struggle for life, think about Darwinists, the survival of the fittest. And Sartre says, that ain't what happens at all. As a matter of fact, there isn't any real sense to it like that. Every existing thing, he says, is born without reason, prolongs itself out of strength? No, out of weakness. What preserves us in our being is not strength, but weakness, and dies by chance. Existence is a fullness with which man can never abandon, he says. And he goes on and talks about the naked natural world, he says. I knew it was the world, the naked world suddenly revealing itself. And I choked with rage at this gross, absurd being. You can't even wonder where all that sprang from, or how it was that a world came into existence rather than nothingness. It didn't make sense. Again, this is absurdity. And what is his response to absurdity? For most of the novel, it has been this sense of nausea for things being out of place, of fear. Now he feels rage. But it's a kind of blind rage. It's not a rage that will actually get anything accomplished. He says, it didn't make sense. The world was everywhere, in front, behind. There had been nothing before it. Nothing. There had never been a moment in time in which it could not have existed. That was what worried me. Of course, there was no reason for this flowing larva to exist, but it was impossible for it not to exist. So, existence is, at the same time, absurd, and also, metaphysically, necessary, unavoidable. All there is, here's the key, take it home, all you get, that's it, that's all you get, according to Sartre. Ultimately, you can have whatever thoughts about it you like, you can say whatever about it you like, but this is all you actually get. So, what is his response to this? In this rage, he says, I shouted filth, what rotten filth, and I shook myself to get rid of this sticky filth. But it held fast, and there was so much, tons and tons of existence, endless. I stifled at the depth of this immense weariness, and suddenly the park emptied as though a great hole, the world disappeared as it had come. Or else I woke up. In any case, I saw no more of it. Nothing was left but the yellow earth. So he's had this massive experience of nausea, things unveiling himself, and he rages against it, and then it ends. And a little bit later, very interesting part. I know I've used this word interesting an awful lot during this, but I'm really fascinated by this. Later on in the book, he'll talk about the city, which is imbued with human meaning. And so you might say, okay, let's get away from that, let's go to nature. He says, nature's even worse. Thank God for the city. I don't want to go out there in the green and this, you know, blooming profusion of things, because that's just still this. So that is existence. That is all of these things: time, existence, self-knowledge, others, for Sartre. What I want to talk about now, before we end, is his relationship with one other character. And Roquentin has been a lover with this woman, Anny. And they're going to talk about time in very interesting ways. Their time has passed, but now they're going to reunite for a brief moment. And she's changed, of course, and he's changed. She's actually, you know, now being kept by somebody. She's left her field being an actress. She's gotten fat. But a change of mind has come about for her. So Roquentin was motivated by the need to have adventures. Annie is motivated by the need to have perfect moments. Another way of understanding time. And again, it's something that we can all relate to, I think, either because we ourselves desire them or because we know others who desire them as well. So, she admits, actually, that she's kind of set him up to you know, not satisfy her in many ways, trying to get from him perfect moments. She says, don't you remember your misdeeds anymore? You came, you spoke, you went, all contrarily. Suppose nothing had changed. You would have come in, there had been masks and shawls on the wall, I'd been sitting on the bed, and I would have said, well, what are you waiting for? Sit down. And naturally, I'd have carefully avoided telling you, except on the armchair near the window. Roquentin says, you set traps for me? She says, they weren't traps. So naturally, you'd have gone straight over and sat down. He would have ruined it. That was her constant thing, that he was ruining perfect moments. And then she ends up saying, I've learned something. I have a sort of physical certainty. I feel there are no more perfect moments. I feel it in my legs when I walk. I feel it all the time, even when I sleep. So this is not just a thinking thing. This is a feeling thing. This is to the core of her being. There has never been anything like a revelation. I can't say, starting on such and such a day at such a time, my life has been transformed. But I always feel a bit as if I'd suddenly seen it yesterday. Now, she goes on and she explains, she goes into this entire ontology of perfect moments and what she calls the privileged situation. And what was a privileged situation? She says they were situations which had a rare and precious quality, style, if you like. To be a king, for example, when I was 8 years old, seemed a privileged situation to me, or to die. So these are times of meaning when, you know, what you're going to do, the actions that you're going to take, and the actions that other people are going to take, and the surroundings that you're in, the physical objects, they all matter. These are sort of like, you know, putting us into a narrative. You know, adventures put us into a narrative one way, this puts us into a narrative another way. And during a privileged moment, during a privileged situation, a perfect moment could arise if everybody did what they needed to do. The trouble is, you can't count on the other people to do what they need to do. And he says, or she says, I developed all that later on, first I added a new situation. Love, I mean the act of love. Look, if you've never understood why I refused certain of your demands, here's your opportunity to understand now. For me, there was something to be saved. Then I told myself there should be many more privileged situations than I could count. Finally, I admitted an infinite number of them. And he says, good, what were they? So she says, it was especially necessary for people to be impassioned, carried away by hatred or love. And the perfect moments, where did they come in? They came afterwards. First there are enunciatory signs. Then the privileged situation slowly, majestically comes into people's lives. then the question of whether you want to make a perfect moment out of it. And so Roquentin says, I understand. In each one of these privileged situations, there are certain acts to be done, certain attitudes to be taken, words which must be said, and other attitudes. Other words are strictly prohibited. Is that it? She says, I suppose so. And then he says, this is sort of like a work of art. And she says, no, it was a duty. You had to transform privileged situations into perfect moments. It was a moral question. Yes, you can laugh if you like. It was moral. And this also is a conception of time and the human being that can't work according to Sartre. And so he has Anny say, that's how I thought I was going to make things matter. That's how I thought I was going to find myself and also find you. Roquentin has had his own loss of adventure and also the loss of his project. She has as well. Now they are in an absurd universe. And you know, you could say, all right, now at least they're on the same level playing field and they can get together and live out the rest of their lives. You know, they're already familiar with each other. They've already had their sort of, you know, come-downance rather than come-uppance. But that doesn't happen. This doesn't produce solidarity. He actually explains his whole metaphysical experience to her, and she's like, okay, I get it, but I don't get it. And she ends up going her way, he ends up going his way, and that's where it's going to leave off. There is no ultimate human contact. There is, in the end, something like despair, and then just going on with things. That's Sartre. And that is, you might say, his philosophy in a nutshell, put into the form of a character in a novel. This isn't the only way that you can see existentialism, but it's one very powerful way of understanding what it would be to live in a world like the one that is being sketched out here. It's a very compelling view on things. So, that is where I'm going to leave off. This is one understanding of the genuine meaning of existence and what it is to be a person, what it is to have self-knowledge, what it is to be related to others, and what it is to live in time. So we'll leave off there.